So very good to see you. And can I start right at the start by saying thank you to all those of you who have decided to step up to the plate and join. It's enormously appreciated at a very important moment in time. So this election was a hammer blow to the Liberal voice in this country. And for those of us who lost many valued colleagues, for all those candidates, great candidates, who failed to win their seats, this was an enormously distressing and traumatic experience. That moment probably so many of us in this room remember at 10 o'clock when we heard the exit poll. But we are where we are, and we now have to fight back. We have to respond to the situation we're in. And for me, it has to be about the reason. Why is it that it's so important to have a strong, progressive, liberal voice in this country? That's what we need to focus on as we seek to rebuild our party. We should not obsess about just the self-preservation of our party for its own sake. We should obsess about the liberal values and the importance of those values in this country, particularly at a time when they will be under enormous threat in a Conservative government without the constraining influence of the Liberal Democrats. So that is the challenge we face. So the question then is, why am I standing to be the leader of this great party? And I should just say to you, I can confidently predict that this is an election which will be won by a Liberal Democrat. It's reassuring for all of us, I'm sure, after what we've been through. But I'm standing not because of a hankering after a position, but because I have a very strong commitment to liberal values. And at the heart of my liberalism is the sense that we must trust in people, that we must take power away from unaccountable institutions and give it to people. Always give it to people. All those people, my goodness, things are strange things are happening.
Oh, no!
All those people who in our country have... Do I wait whilst...
Yes, hold on a minute. There we go.
Right.
You're obviously not moving around enough, Norman.
What are you going to do to Tim? So look, all those people in our country who have no voice, who get ignored by the system. I was at a new members event last night and I heard an incredibly inspiring speech by Anoud Al-Samarai, one of our brilliant councillors in Southwark. And she talked about how a Labour council did things to people, not giving them power in their communities, not allowing them to decide how they wanted to live their life, but in a paternalistic way, doing things to people. And we must always, as Liberals, fight against that because we are completely different. It is about giving power to people. And in everything that I have done, I guess throughout my adult life, I've tried to apply my liberal values to what I do. So when I was a councillor in Norwich, when I was leader of the opposition to a Labour council, in my job as a lawyer, I fought and won on behalf of 5,000 women who were discharged from the armed forces because they got pregnant. That was the rule that existed until the mid-90s. We fought for compensation for those women against much pressure from the Daily Mail, but we won compensation for those women. And then as a campaigning MP, fighting and winning a groundbreaking case on freedom of information, something again that I feel very strongly about, opening up decision-making. And then as a campaigning minister, in my job as a minister in the Department of Health, I kept seeing cases, particularly of people who suffered from mental ill health or from learning disability, who were treated like second-class citizens by the system, ignored too often, outrageously. And for me as a minister, I wasn't going to defend a system that did that to people. I campaigned against it. And let me just tell you the story very briefly about young Josh, a lad now 13, with autism. Family comes from Cornwall. He was placed in an institution in Birmingham, hundreds of miles away from home. After 2 years of fighting and getting nowhere, his father was just desperate and totally frustrated. Just imagine the strain on the family trying to see their son hundreds of miles away from home, the cost to that family, and the decision makers ignoring them. So I got the decision makers up from Cornwall, I got them to meet the family and forced them to listen to that family and to do something about it. Now, thankfully, Josh will return home next month to his family. And Phil, his dad, was so pleased and relieved that at long last someone listened and did something about their situation that he has joined the Liberal Democrats. How good is that? So then, I found this was not an unusual case. So many times I found people who were fighting against the system and getting ignored. The father of a lad in Winterbourne View, do you remember that awful horror of people with learning disability suffering abuse in a private hospital? And I remember the father, Steve, saying to me, I felt guilty because there was nothing I could do for my son and no one would listen. But it's no good just taking up these individual cases. You have to try and change the system to give real rights to these people. So we came up with proposals and a green paper to give new rights to people with mental health problems and learning disability to challenge decisions and to have control over how the money is spent. Now, it is up to this Conservative government to implement those proposals, and I will be watching very closely. But it's interesting, there was no mention of it. No mention of a bill that would give rights to people, disadvantaged people. No mention in the Queen's speech at all. So these are the things that we have to fight for on behalf of people who need us fighting for them. And it's interesting, it's that central principle of the power of people over the power of the state that makes us so determined to fight to protect the Human Rights Act against assault from this Conservative government. And we will fight to ensure that it is protected in every way that we can. But there are other essential liberal values that I just wanted to mention to you. The importance of celebrating diversity wherever we can, of promoting diversity, and of always rejecting conformity. This is central to our values as liberals. The idea that we must always fight against and be intolerant of injustice, of discrimination, wherever we see it. And the central principle that every child in our country must have the same right to make the very most of their abilities and to flourish as individuals. And it is surely a scandal of our time that there are still so many children in our country whose future still is determined by the circumstances of their birth. That for us should be absolutely intolerable. But you know, along with freedom comes responsibility. Responsibility to one another in our communities, but also responsibility to the planet, to future generations, and internationally to work with others for a better world. These are the things that are at the heart of my liberalism, and I suspect for many of you as well. Now, let me just deal with the fight back, the way we return to build our voice as a liberal force in this country. There are those who say that it's inevitably a generation of the long, hard slog, the years in the wilderness, decades potentially, of just rebuilding the liberal voice. I'm actually more optimistic than that. This is a volatile political age. It's a volatile age in all sorts of ways. Big corporations that dominate the landscape suddenly disappear. New startups emerge and catch fire and build into enormous, new, exciting organisations. And we can learn those lessons. This is a liberal age. There are so many people out there who share our liberal values, but who at the moment don't associate themselves with the Liberal Democrats. Our job, our task, is to reach out to those people, to convince them that we are the party that will represent their values, that will be consistent and thoughtful and full of conscience in the way we articulate those values. And over the next 5 years, the Conservatives will face enormous challenges, and they will become unpopular. Just think of those £12 billion of welfare cuts without any indication of where the cuts will come. They will impact on low-income families, they will impact on disabled people, and they will impact on those suffering from mental ill health. I find that intolerable, and we must fight against it. But the Conservatives also have a massive challenge in how we maintain our public services at a time when they are still trying to sort out the deficit, and a complete refusal from the Conservatives to contemplate any tax increase for the very wealthy. They will have a massive challenge in squaring that circle. And then there's the European referendum. This will divide the Conservative Party, and from this point on, they will have no one else to blame but themselves for the difficulties that they get in. And on the other side, Labour is an anachronism. They are still dominated by organised Labour, with union bosses seeking to dictate the agenda to that party. That doesn't fit with modern Britain. So the duty falls on us to build a liberal, progressive force that connects with people who share our values. That force must build on the great liberal governments of the past. It must build on the inspiration of Beveridge, of Paddy Ashdown, of Shirley Williams, all the great figures who have done so much for the liberal cause. And we can fight back. Let me just end by saying this to you. This great liberal cause, we will fight to ensure that the liberal voice is heard and is powerful again for all those millions of people who need us. We will fight to ensure that the politics of hope triumph over the politics of fear. We will fight to ensure that we make a difference for people in their lives so that people can lead a happy life. Liberal values, the triumph of hope and making a difference for people. This is my cause. This is our task together. This is my vision. If you share it, I hope you will consider supporting me. And together, we can triumph. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Norman, and it now gives me great pleasure to introduce Tim Farron, who in the last coalition government was our international spokesperson, but he was also party president as well, and he represents Westmorland and Lonsdale. Tim.
I do. Sal, thanks very much. Norman, thank you very much. And welcome all of you. I am 3 weeks since the general election result, which I think astonished most of us. If I'm honest with you, I didn't expect it to be a wondrous romp to 326 seats and an overall Liberal Democrat majority. I didn't expect what would happen. And I was stunned. You focus on your own count. We were the only place in the entire United Kingdom in Westmorland where the Liberal Democrats got more than half the vote. Seemed to be going all right where we were, and then suddenly in came calamity after calamity after calamity. And two things broke me and made me cry in those early hours of the morning. First was Simon Hughes losing his seat. I just saw the injustice of it. The damage the people that man has served for 32 years that will now be served by, frankly, no offence to the guy, but Labour lobby fodder who will not work his socks off for his community the way that Simon did. The second thing that made me cry was Nick Clegg's resignation speech. And the first were tears of angst, the second were of pride, if I'm honest with you. And I know that a number of you, who I've spoken to tonight, and two or three of the other new members' events I've been to, were triggered to join the party by Nick Clegg's words. And I just want to say to you, many of you come to me and have come to us saying, what can we do to help as new members, those of you who are? There's loads, is the answer, and we'll tell you in due time, in due course. But I want to just thank you for what you have already done. You have no idea what a massive fillip you have given to a frankly broken and downhearted group of people. I went into HQ on the Tuesday after polling day, expecting to see absolutely devastated staff who were beside themselves. I wasn't. That's not who I saw. What I saw were energised, excited, motivated people, motivated by this racking up number on the wall of people who have joined the movement because you, like me, believe liberalism is not flaming beaten and we are going to fight to defend it and bring it back from the brink. You joined the party, those of you who did, for a variety of reasons. I know that. I suspect, like me, you share immense pride at what has happened in the last 5 years, the things we have achieved. Ending the detention of asylum, of children of asylum seekers, raising the tax threshold, redistributing money in our schools. The pupil premium is basically a mechanism for sending more money to the very schools that Tories, by definition, don't send their kids to. And that is absolutely powerful. That would not have happened without us. There has never been a greater threat to the liberal movement in this country, and never has liberalism mattered as much as it does today. And I am proud of you, because you recognise that too. So what is liberalism, and what am I about? Well, I say this, liberalism is about freedom. It's about individuals having the right and the power to make choices over their own lives, to meet their own destiny, to fulfil their potential. And that is why the Queen's speech today was so quintessentially illiberal. A threat to the Human Rights Act, a more immediate threat to us in terms of our internet freedoms and protections, their privacy. The threat over extremism orders. But I tell you what, freedom, to my mind, is not just about being protected from an intrusive state, because we as liberals surely know that nothing robs you of your freedom and your liberty more than poverty, poor housing and inequality. And that's why, that's the kind of liberal that I am. And that is why I want to be our leader. And I'll tell you why, above all else, we've had 5 years where we can be proud of what we've done. We've had the most damaging election result in my lifetime. And I am determined that this party is not going to die on my watch. We need a fresh start. And I'm determined to help us do just that. Now, you will all have your stories as to why you joined the party. Those of you who are new to us, those of you who returned, those of you who have been here some time longer than that. So I joined the Liberal Party as it was in the mid-1980s. And I did so because I watched Cathy Come Home. Those of you who have not watched it, Ken Loach's groundbreaking documentary from the late 1960s. It was a repeat, I hasten to add, when I watched it. And it was, above all else, it broke my heart. I sat on the couch in our house in Preston, and I thought, that cannot be allowed to happen. That cannot be allowed to happen. And I went down the shop, the post office, with my pocket money, did not spend it on a Smith single that week. Instead, I bought a postal order. I'll tell you one of those later on, if you want to know. A postal order. And I joined Shelter. And I joined Shelter, and then I joined the Liberals. Because if you want to take action, if you think things are making, if things make you angry, you should turn that anger into energy and into action. And I'm proud of you that you've just done that. And it reminds me that in an election, people will vote out of fear. People will vote using their head or their wallet. But I tell you this, you join a movement, you join a party, you give up your time, your money, your energy, because something gets you in your gut. That's why I'm here. Something made me cry. Something made the hairs on the back of my neck stand on end. That's why I'm involved. And if there is any future for this party, it is by making sure we reach out into Britain and make people move, make people get off their backsides, because something gets them. Something gets them here, right here. You are living proof that there are thousands and thousands, no, already thousands, 14,000 at the last count, but I'll say hundreds of thousands of people in this country who are liberals. Maybe millions of people in this country who are liberals. And my job, if you elect me our leader, is to turn those liberals into liberal Democrats. Because liberalism has never been under more threat than it is now, and never has it been more essential. So, looking back, I don't want to do a long history of the party, but let's be honest, this is not the first near-death experience we've come across. Okay? If you want to Google Grimmond, Steele and Ashdown, the Thorpe scandal, all the rest of it, and without going into any grotty detail, the reality is, when this party was founded, merged the Liberals and the SDP 7 years ago now, we spent a period of time on 0% in the opinion polls. So 8% we should be delighted with. But, you know, we've gone through eras in the past where Joe Grimmond managed a, led a party of just 6 MPs. Bear in mind that 5 of them were elected as a result of a pact with the Tories. Only Joe Grimmond himself actually won his seat in a 3-cornered contest up in Orkney and Shetland. And indeed, David Steele taking over from the Thorpe scandal. We have in the past made sure the Liberal flame burns bright and continues to do so. But those recoveries from near-death experiences in the past, they were not inevitable. And I want to break this to you. Like Norman, I am optimistic, but I'm realistic as well. Our recovery this time is not inevitable either. because in Brimond and Thorpe and Ashdown's day, we were at the very least, this is small beer, very least, the undisputable third party. We have to scrap even for that now. And that is why our ability to communicate with generations of people outside Westminster in a language that means something to them, that is simple, that is powerful, that is primary colours, that is hugely important. And it is why we as a party need to be absolutely forensic in how we rebuild the party. And that is what we have to do. And I'll tell you this, this party's past and its heart and its purpose in the times gone by has been as a grassroots party. Because local government matters in and of its own right, not just because it's a building block to winning parliamentary seats. And our first job is to get out there and build a plan, a strategy to win council seats across the country, to win assembly seats here in London, to go forward in the Welsh Assembly elections and the Scottish parliamentary elections next May also. And you know what, over the last 5 years, I'm trying not to be grim. I don't wish anybody individual harm or anything like that whatsoever. But let's put it this way. For the last 5 years, we've dreaded by-elections. I want to relish the next one. I want to relish the next one, as it gives us the opportunity to single out a simple message that is clearly ours. Going into coalition was the right thing to do. It was the only thing we could have done. But we cannot pretend that it didn't damage or blur our identity. Of course it did. And what we now have to do is be very clear about what that identity is. And the smaller the party, the bigger the issues we need to campaign on. Today, in the Queen's speech, the thing that angered me more than anything else, this won't surprise you given why I joined the party, is the rush to bring in right to buy for social housing association properties. In my constituency in Westmorland, in the Lake District, we have fought tooth and nail to provide affordable homes for local people there, where house prices are 12 times average wages, and now the Tories put us in a position where we might lose them, bit by bit by bit. Devastating, divisive, appalling. We have to campaign on big issues that will grab people. And likewise with human rights, with the Snooker's Charter, with extremism orders, and as Norman has proudly done to date, on mental health. We have to pick big issues and be a campaigning party. There is no point in the eight of us in Westminster trying to shadow every department. There is every point in joining with you in grassroots campaigns that gets this party recognised, known and popular around the country. That is absolutely vital. Secondly, we are the party of Beveridge. I am a Beveridge Liberal and proud to call myself just that. William Beveridge was a member of a political party for the Liberal Party for one, as a member of Parliament, I should say, for the Liberals, for one single solitary year in the mid-1940s. And yet he wrote the blueprint that changed Britain. The National Health Service, the welfare state, state education, council housing, full employment, all because of the work of one Liberal who had the audacity to look beyond what was possible and to do what was necessary instead. That is our job this next 5 years. That is what I want us to achieve. We have a community out there that is desperate for liberalism, desperate for what we can offer. And we've had an election just gone that was won by the politics of fear and narrowness. And maybe this is a crowded political market with all the different colours out there at the last general election. I want to tell you there's never been more space and more room for a Liberal Party. If you listen to the election just gone, it was all about blame and displacement. It's all down to the immigrants, or it's all down to Brussels, or it's all down to the English, or it's all down to the Scots, it's all down to the idle poor, even the idle rich. I say Britain can do so much better than that. Liberalism is about valuing the individual, and it's about making sure that we organise as a party so the individual wins. People will sometimes tell you that the other parties have vested interests and we do not have vested interests. Rubbish. You do have vested interests. They are the powerless people in your street, in your town, in your tower block, in your village. They are our people and we are their party. It's often been said in the times gone by, I've heard people say it often, I heard Paddy say it, I heard Willie Rennie say it, our Scottish leader, just a few months ago, if the Liberal Democrats didn't exist, you'd have to invent them. By golly, now that gets tested. Now that gets tested. And your job now, over these coming weeks, is to make a choice. And us as a party together, Norman and I together, and the whole of the party, all nearly 60,000 of us, and I hope it's going to get many more than that in the years to come, to stand together, because Britain desperately needs a Liberal Party, a Liberal voice that is strong and vibrant and campaigning and resonant and different. Between us, we can do it. I hope you'll give me your support to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Before we start on your questions, and this is a last call for questions, so please, if you've got a bit of paper that you want to hand down, Emma's just at the front here to take them. I'd also like to ask Elaine Bagshaw just to come up for a minute. You're in Tower Hamlets at the moment, and Elaine will explain why she's here. Elaine,
yes.
If you come and stand here, then you get the mic back a bit. Back a bit. Sorry, Claire. Yeah, that's fine.
Welcome to Tower Hamlets. So Tim talked about wanting a by-election. Well, we've got one. So there is currently a by-election for Mayor of Tower Hamlets. There's also one for Council in Stepney Green, which Will, who was welcoming you in, is standing in. So I'm candidate for Mayor. This is a borough that has a lot of Liberal history. Limehouse in Tower Hamlets was where the SDP was launched, and it's where we've decided we're going to launch the real Lib Dem fight back on the streets of Tower Hamlets. It's a borough that definitely needs Lib Dems and needs our values. We have Canary Wharf in the borough, we sit in the shadows of the city and the Shard, and yet 49% of our kids in this borough are growing up in poverty. We've been and knocked on nearly 3,000 doors in just a week and a half. We come across so many times people that are living in housing provided by the council that is damp, it's overcrowded, it's not of a suitable standard. We've got nearly 8,000 homes in this borough that actually are classed as not suitable for human habitation, and yet we've still got people living in them, and 23,000 people sat on a social housing waiting list, and no one really wanting to do anything about it. So we're out talking to people every single evening and at the weekends. Lib Dem values are completely at the heart of the campaign, and a nice, simple message. We're talking about things like building more affordable homes, refurbing the ones that we've got, and we also still have a free council newspaper that most of you won't have because they've all been closed. That costs us £1.5 million a year, which obviously shocks lots of people. What we've said is, well, as Lib Dems, we believe in and people having all of the opportunities to meet their potential, so we're going to take all of that money and create apprenticeships for our young people in the borough so that they have a chance to succeed. It's going down really well on the doorsteps, and we've got the Tories and Labour running completely scared. I have noticed on Twitter that if we do something in Blackpool and Cubitt Town, I'll get something the next day where the Tories are in Blackpool and Cubitt Town. And if we're in Stepney, Labour are suddenly there the next day. This was a by-election that they didn't think we'd even run a candidate in, and they now can't believe the amount of people we've got here. They had Tessa Jowell here on Saturday, and 15 Labour supporters, and I still have 15 people, so we are definitely keeping up. There's an opportunity here 2 weeks tomorrow to make a real difference and make the Lib Dem fight back not just about members and about all the stuff that's been on social media, but about winning back in local government and showing that actually when we go and talk to people, they support what we're saying and that the fight back's real.
Thank you, Elaine. So if you'd like to help Elaine and Will, there are various ways you can do that. You can knock on doors, you can help deliver leaflets, or like me, you can help by telephone knocking on doors instead, and just catch either Elaine or Will at the end. And it's actually quite good fun going out as a group. Will wants to say something.
All of the information is on the Tower Hamlets Liberal Democrat website, so if you
brilliant.
Get a chance to catch one of us, Tower Hamlets Liberal Democrat, got all the events up there, what we're doing every day for the next 2 weeks.
Okay. Right, thank you very much. We're going to move to questions now. I'm going to ask our candidates to try and keep their answers to about 2 minutes. That'll help us get through them. I've divided them into three major groupings. One is liberal philosophy. The next is hardcore politics, coalitions and how we position ourselves. And then the third is policies, which is the largest in terms of lots of different questions on different policies. But I thought it might be sensible to start with philosophy. So I'm going to start with Jamie Halliday's question. How would you articulate what British liberalism is in a way that will resonate with a broad section of the electorate? And I'm going to start with Tim.
Yeah, fine. Thanks, Sal. And that's a good question. I think that philosophy doesn't excite loads of people. It gets me excited, but I'm a weird person. And I think I tried, I suppose, earlier on to do just that. When we talk about liberal philosophy, what do we believe? It's about understanding what is the concept of freedom we're talking about. So liberalism is not libertarianism. It's definitely not laissez-faire. What it is about saying people should have the freedom to be who they wish, to have access to a full range of services that are available, and to have their human rights protected, their privacy protected, their right to marry who they want, live where they want, Those liberal values are unifying, but I think what makes British liberalism distinct to other liberals elsewhere is it is also a social liberalism. It is an understanding, as I said, that nothing robs you of your freedom more than poor housing and poverty and inequality. And so if you believe in tackling the threats to liberalism, you cannot do anything other than tackle poverty and those other challenges to our freedom as well. And so you've got to look at people's experience in their communities. Cathy, in Cathy Come Home, she may have had the right to vote. She had the right to do all sorts of things. They were pretty meaningless when she lived in squalor and didn't have the ability to be able to exercise those freedoms. And one without the other is meaningless. Economic freedoms, social freedoms. That's what makes a British liberal as distinct to anything else.
Thank you. Norman.
We often in the party have a sort of debate about social liberals and economic liberals, and it all gets horribly confusing. I think actually for most people, we're both social liberals and economic liberals. And I think we often create a sort of false distinction between the two. I talked in my introduction about the things that, for me, are so important, and it's about giving power to people. And it's not some esoteric, sort of theoretical principle. It's applied in practical circumstances, in the way we do our politics. And incidentally, we should, as a party, always apply the liberal values that we talk about to the way we run our own party. The importance of diversity, the importance of not having unaccountable power, so that everyone, including all of these amazing numbers of new members, feel involved and feel that they can have a say in the way that our party develops policy. But I think if you apply the principle of empowering, giving power to people in very practical ways, in everything we think about doing, then you can find ways that you connect with people out there. And I made the point earlier that this is a liberal age. There's been the reaction against that liberal age, and you see that in UKIP. But there is a vast mass of people out there who actually share our values, who don't want the sort of statist Labour Party that sees a sort of paternalistic delivery of service from the central state. But they want fairness. They want to give power to those people who are so often without a voice in our system, but they also want to be able to live their lives as they see fit. Just remember what John Stuart Mill said, that if you do something that doesn't affect other people, you should be able to do it. Lead your life as you see fit. It's only when you do things that affect other people adversely that the state should start to interfere. And actually, if we apply those really important liberal principles to practical circumstances the whole time, consistently, then people will start to see what we are about. I suppose I'll just end by saying that my heart rather sank when we were told at the start of the election campaign that we must say the whole time we will cut less than the Conservatives and borrow less than Labour, because we were defining ourselves in relation to others. We weren't telling anyone what we were about. The values, the things that get people, that make people feel strongly and give people the purpose to go out to vote for a particular cause that they believe in. And that's what we've got to get back to.
Thank you very much. The next one is on, and we've had two people, Constance Usherwood and Ben Maitland, broadly asking the same thing. If you had to choose just one thing to define what it is to be a Lib Dem, what would it be? Norman, we're going to go with you first on this one.
Okay. Well, I come back. It's trusting in people and giving a voice to the voiceless. And I've just sought, as I said earlier, I've sought to apply it in everything that I've done. This is not some sort of Johnny-come-lately idea that I've had in my mind. I've just sought in everything, as a lawyer, as a councillor, as a leader of the opposition on Norwich City Council, as a campaigning minister, opening up power, fighting for freedom of information. We had a big case, and some older ones amongst you may remember, we had a big challenge against Tony Blair to get access to the people that he met at Chequers. I was in pursuit of the possibility, the suggestion that Tony Blair had met with a very wealthy Iraqi businessman in the run-up to the Iraq war, and the Guardian was pursuing an investigation. And I asked the question, will you tell us who you meet at Chequers? And I got the answer back, no, we don't give that information. I said, well, that's not acceptable. This should be open information. So I challenged it, and after a very long process, we won. And this was a groundbreaking ruling, which meant that the citizen had the right to know who the Prime Minister and who every minister met in their work, so that we could see who were influencing ministers. When I became a minister and I was asked, will you please disclose all of the people you met with, I thought, oh my God, I was responsible for that. But it's an important principle, open decision making and giving power to people to lead their lives as they choose to lead it.
Tim.
Yeah. It's about protecting the individual, mostly relatively speaking powerless, against the power of the corporate. And that can be the state or it can be big business. And fundamentally, that is our watchword. That is what we should be doing. We are on the side of those who are powerless. We are on the side of the individual, whatever their relationship with the state or indeed with business, commerce, or what have you. And I think that for us, that should drive us to look in many different directions. So kind of my ultimate political hero is a woman who joined the Liberals in 1949, called Neva Oral. She was my councillor in Leyland. I ended up being a councillor alongside her when I was 22 on Lancashire County Council. And she joined the party in 1949. And just to remind you, that was not a great career move at that point in time. And she joined the Liberals because she wanted to belong to a party that would champion the ideals that would protect us against another war and to be supportive of international relations, the kind of international institutions, European cooperation that protect individuals like herself and her family from the losses incurred in that appalling, tragic war. That's how she joined the party. She spent the next 53 years serving her community on the ground in the town of Leyland, fighting for better council houses, fighting to sort out footpaths, fighting to sort out people from poorer backgrounds to get a decent place at a decent school. Because what marks out a Liberal is that your politics are idealistic, they are internationalistic, they are about tackling climate change, they are about freedoms and human rights, but they are always practiced on the stage of the individual and in the community in which you live. And if you have high-minded ideals and you aren't working hard in your community, you're not a Liberal. And you're not achieving liberalism. So for us, it's about the power of the individual versus the power of the powerful.
Thanks. Tim, don't go away because you're answering the next one first. It's from James Sandbach, who is Social Liberal Forum. What will you do to better communicate that we, as a party of social and economic justice, and what our key, what one key initiative would you take as leader to demonstrate that?
Okay. I think we'll start with the first key issue, James, there you are. There are many things that we did in coalition that I felt were right compromises. And there were some things we did which I think made our lives harder and all the rest of it. But I think one very important and totemic thing that we should do and be on the front foot about doing is saying that we would utterly reverse what is now referred to as a bedroom tax. I think that would demonstrate that we were on the front foot on an issue which matters to so many people. So many people voted against us, let's be honest, in the country, because they felt that was cruel and unfair. And I rebelled on that issue, and I didn't do it on many issues, because I felt that was something I found so hard to justify. How do you communicate to an electorate why we are different and why we are better? Because, again, we're on the side of the people. Remember, what we need to do above all else, I would say, in this country, that one of the things that was most lacking from the Queen's speech today was any serious attempt to tackle housing need. When you think that the average first-time buyer in 1983 was spending something like 12% of their annual salary on a deposit, and today that's something like 120% of their annual salary. And you think the average person is not going to buy a home until they're 40, at least, if they ever do, then the lack of a serious programme of social rented and affordable house building in this country is hugely important. And we can talk about the philosophy of social versus economic liberalism. When all said and done, if we don't deliver for people and meet the needs of communities that are desperate for decent housing, then we will have failed. And our job is, again, to look at the ways in which this government will fail, is bound to fail. This last 3 weeks, tragic and appalling though it's been the best advert for the Liberal Democrats ever. Because you've seen what a government without Liberal Democrats looks like. You've seen the fact that £12 billion will come out of the welfare budget. That is an unfindable sum without causing immense human misery. And whilst it's right that we meet the deficit, cut the deficit and clear the deficit, totally unjustifiable that we should do so without raising taxes on the wealthiest people. So those are the ways in which we make sure that the recovery is fair and that we get the balance right between social and economic justice. Again, to make the point clear, we're going to have the finger pointed at us unless we do something about it. Issues like the bedroom tax need to be addressed, and I'll do that as a first off.
Norman.
Well, first of all, I would just make the point that as a party we should absolutely be in favour and support the whole idea of a vibrant, dynamic economy and enabling people to achieve, to make the very most of their talents, whatever it might be. And we have to recognise that you get the resources to apply to social purpose by having a successful economy. And we forget that at our peril. But for me, you asked for one thing in particular. And I should say that I am deeply troubled by the growing gap between the very rich, the super rich, and the rest, and particularly those at the bottom of the income scale. And I buy into the whole spirit level argument about the dangers of a growing divide between the very rich and the rest. But for me, the thing that I think is the most important in terms of ensuring a fair society is that point I made when I started, that we ensure that every child gets the same chance to make the very most of their talents and to flourish as individuals. And that is not the case in our country. So often, disadvantage counts and people end up not being able to achieve what others can achieve because of the way the system disadvantages those people. The pupil premium is something that I think we should be enormously proud of. This is, this year, £2.5 billion targeted at children from the poorest backgrounds, and it holds schools to account for how that money is spent to ensure that they narrow the attainment gap. And the exciting thing is that the latest data from primary schools shows the gap of attainment between children from poorer backgrounds and the rest starting to narrow. That changes lives. It potentially transforms children's lives. I've got a friend who's a head teacher of a school very close to here. The intake is largely Bangladeshi. These are children from some of the poorest backgrounds in our country. There are now children in that school, which is now designated as outstanding by Ofsted, who are getting into the top universities. The first one last year got into Oxford or Cambridge, giving those children opportunity. And I think we should be so proud of what we achieved with the pupil premium. But here's the thing. The Conservatives now are starting to talk about undermining it or scrapping it. And that's a battle we have to fight to preserve something that was literally changing children's lives and was deeply liberal.
Right, the next question, building on the social liberal and economic liberal arguments, two questions, one from Emma. Definitions of left and right in politics can be quite divisive. How will you make sure that any person who wants to be part of the Lib Dems won't feel excluded? And then the similar question, don't have the name of the person who asked it. Tell me how you would unite the classic liberal and social elements of the party. I think, Norman, you're starting with that one.
Okay. you get your head around the next issue. So, I made the point a little earlier that I think we create sometimes a false distinction between economic and social liberalism. So I believe in the absolute importance of discipline in terms of public finances. I don't believe that the state should do everything. I believe in an enabling state. And I absolutely think that this party did the right thing in stepping up to the plate to try to sort out our public finances at a very dangerous time for our country. I keep getting told, and Nick Clegg was saying to me today, people keep saying that history will judge us more kindly than the electorate. He's getting a bit sick of hearing that. but it's true. And that sense of discipline on finances is extraordinarily important. Vince Cable made the point, you don't deliver progressive policies on the back of a bankrupt government. So we have to ensure that we're disciplined on that, that we're prepared to take tough decisions. But absolutely, the things that actually motivate me, the things that have driven me throughout my adult life is injustice, tackling injustice. As a constituency MP, I come across so many cases where people who perhaps aren't articulate, who don't know how to work the system, who don't recognise that going straight to your MP is the right thing to do to get a problem sorted out, and who are crushed by a system, disadvantaged in every way, a lack of power. It's these cases that motivate me, that get me out of bed in the morning, that force me to fight on those people's behalf. And I've always tried to do it, consistently, all the way through, in whatever role that I've had. And so I don't see any distinction in those things. I absolutely want a fairer society where everyone gets the chance to achieve. But I also recognise that we have to be disciplined in the way in which we run our economy.
Tim.
Well, it's very interesting. I think the distinction, which we found very hard to be able to prove during the years of the coalition government, was that we got into power at a time of enormous financial devastation for the country. And the size of the state necessarily needed shrinking. And I agree with that. One of the things we have got out of the years in coalition, and it's been a tough 5 years, but we will hang on to this, is the sense that we are a fiscally responsible party. We lose that at our peril. We need to be a party that people believe can govern, and a party that believes will take the nation's finances and treat them in a serious way. But the massive distinction between ourselves and the Conservatives is that the Liberal Democrats agreed with the savings that were made in public expenditure because of a financial crisis that we'd inherited. And whether you blame the bankers or Labour or, like most normal people, a bit of both, doesn't really matter. We inherited that mess. We made our judgment on that basis because it was a necessity. The Tories made their judgment because they actively believe in a smaller state. My view is that a smaller state equals weak citizens. I don't believe in the Orwellian intrusive state that gets into everybody's life. In fact, I'm a Liberal. I'm hostile to that, to say the very least. However, a state that doesn't provide decent quality health care and schools, that doesn't referee the marketplace, anybody who says they're a free marketeer and believes in an absence of regulation and a laissez-faire is not a free marketeer. Adam Smith, the Liberal economist, talked about there being an invisible hand in the marketplace. You might be aware of that. That's rubbish. He was a Liberal, but it was still rubbish. There is no such, the only invisible force in the marketplace is gravity. In other words, more accretes to that which is already pretty large. And so the only way to have a free market is to referee it. And that's why left and right is a nonsense. Because if you believe as a Liberal in the power of the individual, if you believe that you want to have an economy that is successful, you'll back private enterprise, you'll have ambitious government that leads businesses and allows them to have the space to be entrepreneurs and to make wealth, but you will absolutely not allow people to get into monopolistic positions. You will make sure there is intervention. There are so many goods and services in this country, though, and we've seen this sadly since Margaret Thatcher's day, that absolutely should not and could not sensibly be provided by anything other than the state or a community provider. That our water, our utilities, and all those other things which were privatised by Margaret Thatcher ended up in private hands. They're not in private hands. They're in the hands of other countries now. And the notion that that was a nonsense and a proof that laissez-faire and free market are not the same thing. So I will never answer in a straight way, are you left or right, because it just gets you bracketed. But put it this way, over the next 5 years, our job will be to be the Liberal, the radical, the green, and the distinctive voice against an illiberal and negative Conservative government. and that's the position we must step up to. We have only 8 members of Parliament, which means we will very much depend on our ability to communicate beyond the kind of Westminster circle and the political classes. But if we do that, I'm convinced we can make massive strides forward.
Thank you. The next group of questions, I'm going to take one of them, but they're all about what you would do different as party leader. So thank you, Louis Percent, Benjamin Lansdowne, David Burgess-Bellay and Steve Davenport. Your questions are rolled into Edwin Burrows' question. Looking back over the election campaign and the past 5 years of coalition government, what would you have done differently had you been party leader? Tim.
So I started off by saying that I'm proud, and I am genuinely proud of what we achieved over the last 5 years. And I'm not just going to reel off the list, because you know those things, and we share that pride. And it is absolutely something that I will not have any time for, as an idea that we can somehow distance ourselves and pretend the coalition never happened. But there are clearly things that we could have done differently as a party. And I'm bound to say, fundamentally, the issue of tuition fees. When all said and done, tuition fees policy that we now have, that this the last coalition government introduced, is massively fairer than the one it replaced. That's the tragic injustice of that case. You know, you've got to be earning £70,000 a year as a graduate under the new system, the one we introduced, before you start paying back more every month than under the old one that was replaced. So of course it's fairer. But the problem is this. I saw Nick Clegg wipe the floor with David Cameron and Ed Miliband at Leeds the week before the election. He was comfortably the best candidate on the Hustings that night. And 19% voted for him as to having won that debate. Now, that's more than twice what we got, so we should have settled for that. But nevertheless, it just proves that people have their fingers in their ears. And for so much of the last 5 years, we've had great policies, wonderful achievements like those that Norman made in health, like our policy on the pupil premium, like what we did in terms of raising the income tax threshold. But people weren't listening, because tuition fees was never about tuition fees. It was about trust. And I remember saying at the time that if we did this, if we introduced the increase in tuition fees, irrespective of the merits of what we replaced it with, we would simply do to ourselves what Labour did to themselves over Iraq. So I would have done that differently. But we live and learn.
Norman.
Well, first of all, I think, going back to what Tim has said, that actually trust is critically important to a political party. If you lose trust for whatever reason, people won't listen to you anymore. They will not take you seriously. And we have a massive task now in rebuilding the trust of the British people. We may feel it's unfair in some ways, but that's it. We lost trust. And we must, in everything we do now, seek to convince people that the things we say we will deliver them, and we will be true to our word. So that's the first thing. Central importance of trust. Why? Because if we believe in things and we are able to communicate those beliefs to people, they will only believe us if they see us seeking to deliver it, if they see us being consistent and principled and acting with conscience in the way in which we deal with all of the issues that come along during the course of a parliament. The second thing is about how we communicate what we're about. I mentioned earlier my heart sinking when we defined ourselves in relation to others about cutting less and borrowing less and all of that. We've got to speak to people's values, the things that make people, that motivate people as individuals. And we've always got to be completely clear about that. And then I think we've got to identify issues that people really care about and have something significant to say about them. Now, I've spent 2.5 years as a minister in the Department of Health. I'm actually very proud of the steps that I took to pursue the cause, which I think is a liberal cause, of equality for people who suffer from mental ill health. I managed to connect with people beyond our party and to give our party a credibility in the outside world on an issue where we hadn't previously had much credibility. And I think over the next 5 years, the NHS faces a massive, massive challenge. The financing of the NHS will be extraordinarily difficult for the Conservative Party to manage. And as I said, they are seeking to do it whilst going beyond clearing the deficit. They want to create a surplus, and they completely refuse to increase taxes at all for the very wealthy. So how will they do it? How will they square that circle? And if we've got something significant to say about an institution that this country and the people of this country cares deeply about, it's actually the best system globally. The Commonwealth Fund identified that it's best for quality and indeed for equity. We spend much less than the European average on our health and our care system. But we need a new settlement for the NHS and for the social care system in this country. And critically, we need to complete the task of achieving equality for those suffering from mental ill health. And if we can articulate our message on something that people care deeply about, and if we're consistent with it, and we identify where the system has failed, and if we speak critically in a language that ordinary people use, not the political classes of Westminster, then I believe we can break through and we can start to rebuild our party again.
Right, we're going to move on to next steps now. We've had a range of questions. I'm going to read three or four of them out because I think they're all heading in the same direction. Chris Pryor asks, what is your strategy for your first year in office, and specifically also to regain ground in recently lost constituencies? Louis Persen asks, what about the Lib Dems needs to be modernised and how? Victor Alberto asks, how do you intend to fix the damaged reputation of the party? And then the other two from John Ward and Jacob Adams in this group are about rebranding. Should we rebrand or not? Because won't we lose the successful things we've done in the last 5 years? And how do we turn the strength of our failure into success? Easy. Norman.
Yeah, great, thank you. So first of all, there's a heck of a lot in there, and I'm not going to necessarily remember it all, so forgive me if I don't. In 2 minutes as well.
In 2 minutes.
So I think, first of all, the priorities for the first year as leader. First principle is we must get away from Westminster. This is an archaic institution. I sat in there today for the Queen's speech. There's lots of pomp and ceremony, but it's an outdated institution where the Conservatives now have a majority. We have to get out of that place and get out and communicate our message across the country. And we need to work with our activists all over the country, but particularly in those areas that have elections next year, in those seats where we can win them back from the Conservatives and from Labour at the next election, so that we start to rebuild our potential as a party in holding seats at council level and at parliamentary level. I want to lead a great Liberal campaign across our country for the things that we believe in, including, incidentally, the need, working with others, for a great Reform Act. Our parliamentary voting system is completely broken. It's an outrage that 25% of people in this country voted either UKIP, Lib Dem or Green. Now, they may have been voting in totally divergent directions, but that group of people, that 25% of people, one in four, ended up with 10 MPs. How can you possibly justify that as a Democrat? So let's get out there and campaign for these Liberal values. Let's campaign for an end to the completely corrupt funding of elections, which enabled the Conservative Party to buy seats at the last election, spending a fortune in the seats that we hold, using the power of wealthy individuals to buy elections. Let's fight on these issues and connect again with people around the country. The way we run our party, I think our party is in need of pretty fundamental change, actually. I don't think it's fit for purpose. I hear too many stories of unaccountable power, of people who don't listen to the wider membership, and I have a massive problem with the lack of diversity in our party. Look at our eight MPs. Eight of us white, middle-aged men. It's dreadful. We've completely failed as a party. And we must face up to this and be honest about it and recognise that we have to change. So I said earlier that the liberal values that we espouse and that we communicate to the wider public, we have to run our party consistent with those values. And if we don't, we are diminished as individuals and as a party, and no one will take us seriously. No one will. So we have to promote those liberal values in the way we run our party. Power spread to all members. Diversity, absolutely essential. And for me, an overhaul of the way the party operates must be an absolute priority. I've taken up far more than 2 minutes, and I haven't begin to cover all of the issues, but I'll hand over to Tim.
Okay. To be fair, I cheated. I asked about five, so yeah. Tim, you can have 4 minutes.
That was actually extremely concise. First steps, you've got to work back, and work back from a variety of points. Work back from the general election in 2010, work back from the European Parliament elections in 2019, where, of course, we've only got one seat to defend, work back from the London Assembly, where we have two to defend, Welsh Assembly and Scottish Parliament, all next May, where we have five to defend in both of those assemblies, and indeed from the local elections as well. And you've got to look at what it is you want to achieve, and we want to advance. We want to win more seats. And to do that means building infrastructure on the ground. And you can't will it when it isn't there. So here we have a whole bunch of enthusiasts who are here to make their own luck. You look at the seats that we win. I mean, my constituency, so I said, the only one in the United Kingdom where we got a majority of the votes. And there are loads of other seats like mine, but we lost our deposit. The difference between what we did or what we managed to achieve and another place is not about the demographics, it's about people on the ground making a difference, writing a plan, following a plan, immersed in the community. So you build those plans seat by seat, ward by ward. Just as devastating to me as the loss of 46 colleagues 3 weeks ago is the loss of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of councillors up and down this country these last 5 years. And it's not just the fact that we don't control councils like Kingston or Richmond anymore. It's the fact that in places like Chorley and Lambeth and places like that, we have got nothing, absolutely no councillors whatsoever. And so the strategy is about building back from those elections to create the strength on the ground so that we win. Because without winning, you can't change anything at all. I was out walking my dog with three of my kids about 3 months ago, and we bumped into a couple and their child walking their dog, and we got strung out, and my 13-year-old daughter talked to the woman who basically said to her, "said you should be proud of your daddy, he got us rehoused. You should be very proud of your daddy. We were living in a bedsit in Ambleside, and he got us rehoused." And Gracie told me this when we got home, and I had a little cry. And after I said to her, "look, you deliver the 55 houses in our street, love. So we won a council seat. So we won control of the council. So we built flipping council houses. That's how we housed that family. You did it, sweetheart, not me." And you've got to work back. If you're going to get people to knock on doors, to slog the guts out, to make a difference, they need to know why winning matters. And the first thing is to put fire in the belly of the thousands and thousands of Liberal Democrats up and down the country that it is worth fighting and it is worth winning. Because losing robs you the chance to do that, and winning gives you that ability to do so. And we've got to tackle diversity in a structured way. So first thing, you open the gates on applications for people to become parliamentary candidates. You do it quickly, you go out there and you deliberately recruit, particularly from the underrepresented groups, which frankly is headed by women, but also BAME communities as well. And I've spent 20 years or so in the party, probably taking the liberal line that actually positive action is not terribly liberal. Do you know what? When after year after year after year after year, we have failed to deal with the fact that we have now no women and no people of BAME background in the Houses of Parliament, stuff principles. I want shortlists that will actually get people into the Houses of Parliament so that this party looks like the country it needs to represent.
Thank you, Tim. Right, the next question is much shorter. And I've had two people, I've had Richard Collins and Jonathan Coates asking, how are you going to get the Lib Dems in power next time round? And Richard adds, in the face of such a hostile media.
Hey, again.
You again.
Right. Okay, well, look, The point is, worry about what you can affect. And we're going to decide how many parliamentary seats we can realistically have a go at. We're going to throw the flipping kitchen sink at them. And that's what we can affect. And we have a fruit machine of an electoral system, which we don't agree with. And we'll see what it gives us. But seat by seat and ward by ward, we can decide, we can affect the outcome of the next general election and the elections in the run-up to them. Hostile media, I mean, I'm sorry. The Independent and the Standard are owned by a Liberal Democrat supporter. I think that's, I don't know if that's an official fact, but he's certainly a sympathiser, and he's a really, really great guy. However, as Bob Dole once said of his Democratic opponent in a Senate election, the thing about a Liberal is they're too reasonable to take their own side in an argument. So even if you had some colossal Liberal Murdoch out there, he probably still, or she probably wouldn't defend our case anyway. Look, liberalism and modern liberalism, post-war liberalism, saw its fight back under Grimmon in many ways in the city of Liverpool under Sir Cyril Carr. And he introduced what we refer to as the Focus newsletter these days, or it's called Church Ward News back then. And he did that, why? Because the flaming Liverpool Echo wouldn't print his press releases. So if they won't tell you, if your message won't go through the normal media, you create your own look, you make your own structures. That is why social media is so powerful, but never, ever, ever think that social media should be used as anything other than a virtual means for getting an actual result. It is not a substitute for knocking on doors. It is not a substitute for delivering bits of paper and actually meeting human beings. People get galvanised by face-to-face contact and by people who will inspire them, and that's what I would want to do, and that's what we must do as a party looking forward. And that way, we create our own look, our own story, our own narrative in the seats that we can win. We build our bridgehead, we go from there.
Norman.
Well, first of all, on the hostile media, I mean, it was extraordinary, the power of the operation that we faced at this election. And you think about the Telegraph, the Times, the Daily Mail and the Sun. And I looked at a week's worth of Times front pages on my iPad, and every single one of those front pages over a full week was promoting the camera message about fear or attacking Miliband. And to have your message sort of so supercharged by all of those newspapers pumping it out day after day, even though the power of the press, of the hard copy newspapers is somewhat diminished, it's still very powerful. And we had nothing like that to fight back with. But I come back to what I said earlier, that I think, first of all, we've got to be clear and consistent about the values so that we again connect with people and people start to identify with us because we are the party that's speaking to their values. And that, in a way, also is the way in which you energise your activists. If activists feel that there's something worth fighting for, that there's something that's consistent and clear and speaks to their values, then they will go out and do all of the work to fight to secure them. And we have to be totally disciplined about the seats that we target, the effort that we make to make sure that we make those gains at the next election. But just remember this, that I mentioned this in my opening remarks, things change very rapidly these days. All of the old assumptions about the world have changed completely. Those corporations that have been household names that have just disappeared overnight, the startups that catch fire and become very large very quickly. Look at in politics, the fact that the SNP emerged very quickly in a sort of revolution in Scotland because they connected with people about things that they cared about. And even, God forbid, Nigel Farage, preaching a message of division in total contrast to our message of uniting people. But he connected with people. He connected with people who had a grievance, who had complaints about the modern world. So we, as Liberals, have got to fight back. And if we can connect with all of those people who share those values, then I think there is no reason why that can't catch fire if we identify the issues that bring it alive for people and we do it consistently and we do it in a way that speaks their language, that isn't from the Westminster bubble, then I think there's every reason to believe that this startup could be a great liberal progressive movement of change. And when you have a Labour Party, as I said, that is an anachronism, it's just not fit for purpose. And yet so many people in our country want an alternative to the Conservatives that isn't statist. If we can connect with those people, then I think we can rebuild much faster than many people imagine.
Thank you, Norman. The next three questions are based on nationalism, and you touched, Norman, just now on the SNP and UKIP. Jeremy Kernthaler, please forgive me if I'm pronouncing names wrong, says, is the SNP-UKIP, or nationalism in general, now a permanent feature of British politics? If so, what can the Lib Dems do to respond? Thomas Thorpe says, what would you do to save the union? And Roger Light says, what will you do to revive Lib Dem support in Scotland? So, Norman, you're starting with that one.
Well, I think the phenomenon of the SNP and the phenomenon of UKIP are actually, they would absolutely deny it, both of them, but I think it's rather similar. It's the politics, as Nick has said, of grievance, of identifying something to complain about the way in which politics works, the sense of remote power, the sense that people no longer have any control over their lives. And if we just represent politics as usual, the sort of part of the establishment, then we will not connect to people. And I often think that sometimes these days, some of our leaflets, we sort of trade meaningless insults with other parties, and we have slogans that we throw at each other, but we don't get under the skin of the communities that we seek to represent. And in Tower Hamlets on Saturday, I was thinking to myself, what is it that is going to give these people in this community, this disadvantaged community, a reason to vote for us? We always have to think in that way. Why would people vote for us? And so instead of the sort of facile sometimes leaflets that go through letterboxes, we've got to, again, think about what's wrong with that community. Is it that they have no control over the schools in their community, have no control over housing, over their health services, that they feel that there are people who aren't listening to them? And there's a fascinating crowdsourcing initiative being taken in London and some other cities where they're asking people what they want to do in their communities. And we should be about giving those communities some control again, giving them some access to the resource that can change their lives, building support so that people start to identify with the Liberal Democrats because we are the party that are giving them power. And I think in that way, we can start to rebuild our reputation and we can be consistent with what we actually believe in.
Tim.
Yeah, I mean, if you're feeling any time lonely and you're a Twitterer, compare the SNP to UKIP and you will be deluged by what we refer to as the cybernats. I absolutely think it's important to understand that the SNP is a centre-left, perhaps more than centre-left, political movement, and that UKIP isn't. But when all said and done, if you wrap yourself in a flag, if you play the politics of identity, you're from the same stable. You're from the same stable. I would be careful to go no further than this, but look, nationalism can be a force for progress when it is insurgent. I can't think of a single case of it being anything other than reactionary when it is ascendant. And what part of nationalist one-party state sums up anything decent about Scottish values? Scotland is better than that. And I say that as somebody who lived very close to the border, got family in Scotland, some family in Scotland who vote SNP. And if we are not careful, though, while we must be robust with nationalism and say we are the anti-nationalists when all said and done, we mustn't denigrate and demean folks who choose to vote for nationalist parties. There is generally a reason, an underlying one. And when we're looking at immigration, for example, as an issue, as a concern, generally speaking, what we're talking about is a lack of provision. It's a lack of provision of services. If you can get a GP appointment, if you've got enough, if your housing is decent, if you're being paid reasonably, then look, you don't go looking for anybody else to blame. Often the grievances that are used by nationalists, it's all about divide and rule. The powerful getting one set of powerless people to blame another set of powerless people for things that are the powerful's fault. And we need to get underneath that, not get cross with UKIP or SNP, but be critical of ourselves for failing to have been part of a movement that took advantage of people who felt powerless and atomised. And the union, well, part of me thinks the union's under no threat whatsoever, because Nicola Sturgeon and David Cameron need each other so much. I mean, quite clearly, to win an election, you need a bogeyman. And Nicola Sturgeon was David Cameron's, and David Cameron was Nicola Sturgeon's. If they ever left the United Kingdom, the SNP would have no one to blame, and people wouldn't vote for them. But I think that's a little bit cynical. The reality is that the SNP do want an independent Scotland. The time for that question to be asked again may come again. And our job is not to demonise Scotland. Our job is not to do what David Cameron did in order to win a general election. Just think, for short-term electoral benefit, David Cameron caused long-term, maybe eternal, national damage. What a disgrace. What the least statesmanlike thing you can imagine. I remember a year ago, and you've almost got to commend them for this, a year ago, the Tories' best line on the doorstep in the literature that wiped out so many of our colleagues didn't even exist. The SNP did not exist in May 2014. And so things change. You've got to be fleet of foot. But reaching out to Scotland and making sure we make common cause and making the case for the union is so vital. And for Liberal Democrats, don't forget that in so many of the seats that we lost, our vote went up. In Joe Swinson's seat, in Gordon, in Argyll and Bute, in Alan Reid's constituency, the Liberal Democrat vote went up. It's just the SNP vote shot past it. And what goes up can absolutely come back down again. And we need to understand that whilst the SNP have a great strength because they are both in power and opposition at the same time, what a wonderful gift that must be, we mustn't let them get away with it. And as we devolve more to Scotland, and rightly so, the SNP have to take more and more responsibility for the decisions they make. So I believe in better together in Europe and in the United Kingdom. We need to make that case with those positive values and not let the SNP demonise us as if we're all about Margaret Thatcher or all Edward I. Because the reality is, we're not. And we need to reach out to the North and hug them to death, not fight back with the same language that they use to us.
Thanks, Tim. Right, the next two questions are about the coalition that's just finished. Ollie Griffiths asks, how would you describe your support for the coalition policies when in government? And Jamie Halliday asks, are there any policies, decisions or actions that the Lib Dems supported in government that you would say publicly we should not have done? And I'm really going to start timing you guys on this, so 2 minutes max, Tim.
I mean, look, we were given an opportunity in that first, second week of May 2010, which was really undeniable. We either went into coalition with the Conservatives, or there was a minority Tory administration in our judgment, I think it's the correct one. David Cameron would have gone for a second election in October and November, and he would have had a majority. And all those things that we've been able to stop, and indeed do, over the last 5 years, well, those things wouldn't have been able to have taken place, and Britain would have been poorer for it. We had the right decision. There are various things that clearly, I don't want to do a great long list, but there's clearly some things that I thought that we shouldn't have done. I mentioned tuition fees and the bedroom tax, the NHS bill, and secret courts. But when all said and done, when you get into power, it's about making compromises. And I voted against those things. I did so carefully. I thought about it. Because I think whilst it is right to stand up for what is right against secret courts, in favour of those things which Liberals hold absolutely dear, it's also a valuable thing to be a team player. And so I'm sure I cost myself, you know, I was elected party president, so I'll never know, but I'm sure I cost myself a place as a minister because of that. But I took the view that there are some issues where you've just got to stand firm and be distinctive and make sure our voice doesn't get lost in all this. I recall being spoken to by the then leader of D66. The Dutch are so liberal, they've got two liberal parties. And D66 was led by a lady called Lucevice van der Laan, who pointed at Norman and I and about 50 of the rest of us shortly after the coalition was formed. She said, you guys are the biggest liberal party in Europe, and you've always been the most powerless. You had clean hands, but they were empty hands. That's a good way of putting it. She said, remember, coalition is not marriage, it is business. And I think maybe we should have understood that a little bit early. At the Rose Garden, it made it look a little bit like it was marriage. It was business. For us to get things done for our people, for the powerless, to bring liberal movement, liberal values into practice. And perhaps we failed to do that a little bit because we lost our identity in those first few days. It's an easy mistake to make, and we won't make it again.
Norman.
In terms of the mistakes and the things we did wrong and the things that I would feel now that we should not have done, the bedroom tax, I remember at the time the discussion in the parliamentary party, and I remember the anxiety that I had that people who were currently in accommodation that had spare rooms, and I thought about my own constituency and the fact that it's just incredibly difficult to downsize because there are no homes available at a smaller size. I expressed my concern, but ultimately we went along with it, and we shouldn't have done, in my view. And I think we were right then to be very clear that the experience of the bedroom tax, which has meant, in fact, that there are many people on low incomes who faced a significant cut in their weekly income, that was wrong and that we should change it. And so that's my first thing. The second thing is sanctions for people who fail to follow proper process in claiming their benefits. I don't have a difficulty with the idea that someone who simply refuses to take responsibility for themselves, that there should be some consequences for that. But there are many people on benefit who suffer from quite significant mental ill health. And the idea that if you fail to turn up for an appointment, it may well be because of your illness that you fail to turn up. And the idea that we then penalise them, punish them for that, I find very difficult to accept. And so I think we were absolutely right in the general election to argue that that must be changed, but I don't think we should have gone along with it. But let me just, on the other side of the coin, talk about some of the things that I did that I'm actually very proud of. And at the end of the day, what is the point of being involved in politics if you don't get stuck in, step up to the plate, and try and pursue and achieve liberal values in government, whether it's in local government or in national government? And in my role working in mental health, we have managed over the last 5 years to increase the number of people who get access to psychological therapies from about 300,000 a year to 900,000 a year. That's an awful lot of people who are now getting access to therapies that can help them recover, to get back into work, to have a better, happier life. That's an advance for people. The fact that in the last 2 years we've seen a 50% reduction in the number of people who scandalously end up in police cells at a moment of mental health crisis. We have made real progress. Every time someone avoids being placed in a police cell, that is a dreadful experience saved for that individual. We should be pleased that we have managed to do that. Let me tell you about another scheme that you probably know nothing about. There are very many people, I'll make this last point, there are very many people in our country who are in prison because they suffer from mental ill health or learning disability. We have established something called a liaison and diversion service. We're rolling it out across the country. And as one of the leading people in mental health said to me, there is no other country in the world that is doing this on the industrial scale that we are doing, to divert people away from prison and into treatment. That is something we should be very proud of. And it's what we did in government. And it's what being a Liberal is all about, having values and seeking to implement them in government.
Thank you. So that was a question about past coalition. Roger Light, Thomas Thorpe and Ben Maitland and Gabriel Doherty are all asking about future coalitions. Gabriel's is the shortest question. Would you enter into a coalition with either the Tories or Labour in the future? Norman.
Well, first of all, if we're a party that believes in pluralism, that believes in a voting system that reflects the way people feel and vote in the way people are represented in Parliament, then it would be completely inconsistent of us to say we won't go into coalition with anyone. So the answer to the question must be that we must be prepared to contemplate going into coalition. And surely, going back to what I said just now, if we're Liberals and we care about Liberal values, surely we should all be about seeking to implement them in government. If we're not, what is the point of us all being in this room, spending an evening talking about things that we care about, if we don't seek to implement them in government? So that must be a central principle about what we're about. But I just say this to you. The current voting system for third parties is utterly punishing. It can destroy you, as we've discovered. So for me, a principle and a condition of any coalition in the future for us must be that we change the voting system so that people's votes are reflected in the representation in Parliament. I said to you that the system is now completely discredited, and we have to be the ones who seek to change it to ensure that our pluralist society is properly represented in government. And if we can secure that, we should be up for coalition. And we cannot say that we'll only go into coalition with one other party, because that makes us an adjunct of that party. It's ridiculous. So we must be open-minded, and our sister parties across Europe are open-minded about who they go into coalition with. The central principle is implementing liberal values in government. Surely, that's what we must be about.
Thank you. Tim.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm going to make a guess that nobody in this room joined the Liberal Democrats as a career move. If you did, well, okay. But I also hope nobody joined the Liberal Democrats as a cop-out either. Because if you were involved in politics, you may well have chosen the hard route. You have chosen the hard route. But you've chosen the route to try and make things better, to make a difference, and you should want power. There is nothing grubby about wanting to win elections and to take power, because if you win elections and you take power, you can make a difference. And 5 years ago, we put, I would say, the party's interests significantly secondary to those of the country's. Do you know what's in the national interest today? That the Liberal Party survives and thrives. That's what's in the national interest. And that is our primary objective over these next 5 years, starting right now. Of course, you don't write off coalitions with either of the party. You shouldn't be doing anything that implies that you are of one side or of the other. But what we clearly did in this election, it was a strategy which perhaps we held for too long during this Parliament, was to make out that, look, you need the Liberal Democrats because we temper one side or the other. You need the Liberal Democrats because we would qualify the excesses of one side or the other, a split the difference approach. And look, if we'd won alternative vote, that would be a reason to give us your second preference. And I'm sure there's loads of people by polling day who didn't hate us anymore and quite liked us, just not enough to vote for us. And our focus, our absolute resolute focus this next 5 years, is to give people real, hard reasons to vote for us. Not just clear policies and values and campaigns they buy into, but the interaction on the ground. If you saw how the Liberal Democrats did far better in those places where we were able to concentrate human and other resources, that is the job going forward. And when it comes to future coalitions, we've got to look at them. We will be wiser doing it a second time, for sure. And we mustn't think that our fate is sealed. We mustn't think anything other than optimistic, though realistic, thoughts going ahead. I mentioned D66 earlier on. Their current leader, Sophie Interfeld, 7 years ago, she reminded us the other day that, look, the D66, after having been the junior partner in the coalition 7 years ago, got nearly wiped out. And then 6 years later, they topped the poll last year in the European elections. So being clear about what you're for, not just hungry for coalition, clear about what you're for, is clearly the way back into the hearts and the ballot boxes across the country.
Thank you. We're going to move now into some very short. I'm going to get you down to a minute each, guys, because we're on to specific policy questions. So the first one is from Toby Keynes from the Humanist and Secularist Lib Dems. Party has clear policies against caste discrimination, for legal recognition of humanist marriage and for assisted dying. Which of these policies do you think the party can now pursue most effectively? That's the first one. Tim.
Okay. The first two in particular, humanist weddings, something I'm very much in support of. I think in terms of those, the other issue, I think assisted dying is a much more complex situation, if I'm honest with you. When all said and done, I think if you clarify the legislation to the extent that you permit by law assisted dying, opens a massive, massive Pandora's box, which is in many countries in Europe has been problematic and a threat to the vulnerable. On the other hand, if you clarify the legislation in such a way as you make it clearly punishable if a person out of mercy and sympathy and compassion, as someone who basically nursed my mum in her final months, she died far too young, 10 years ago in her 50s, you know, I have absolute compassion and empathy. The danger is if you clarify too much, you either open the Pandora's box or you unfairly and cruelly punish people who are acting out of mercy. It's one of these rare areas where actually a bit of fogginess is the least bad solution.
Norman.
Well, I don't actually agree with that. I think that assisted dying is actually a big liberal issue. I totally respect the views of those who disagree with it for profound religious reasons. But for me, it is a central question. Should it be you, me, or the state that decides? And I just think it has to be. The answer is clear. It must surely be the individual that decides. The Faulkner Bill that was introduced into the House of Lords in the last Parliament dealt with those who were terminally ill in the last 6 months of their life, according to two doctors' judgment. There were safeguards built into the bill. And if I asked myself the question, would I, in those circumstances, facing potentially pain and suffering, either for me or for a loved one, would I want the right to make a decision, a clear right, not a foggy right, a clear right, then my answer is absolutely yes. Bless you. answer is absolutely yes. It must be the right. And just think about this. We put families in the most invidious position. The Director of Public Prosecutions has issued guidelines which says that essentially if it's very clear that it's a mercy situation, that the person has acted out of compassion, that there should not be a prosecution. But what happens before that decision is reached by the police and the Crown Prosecution Service? Your home becomes a crime scene. There is a murder investigation launched. There has to be, under the current law, before a decision is taken under those DPP guidelines. That surely is intolerable. How can we put families in that situation? And there are now many other countries where the law has been changed, where safeguards are in place, and where the dreadful things that people fear haven't happened. And so for me, as part of my liberalism, it must be about giving the individual and their loved ones the right to make a decision rather than the state saying, no, if you proceed, then you could be prosecuted. That surely must be wrong.
Thank you. The next is from Jacob Kishiri. Where does liberalism meet pragmatism in addressing extremism on university campuses? Norman, that's you to start.
Well, I believe fundamentally in the principle of freedom of speech and the right to exchange views and ideas, but I do not believe in the right to incite violence or racial hatred. And that's a really important dividing line, surely, for liberals. And there is a danger with the agenda that this government is going to pursue, which is designed, they will say, to make us all safer. But if it ends up acting as a recruiting sergeant for extremists, it ends up achieving the very opposite of what they seek to achieve. And, you know, for me, the way in which we combat extremism is by education, actually. And I think back again to the school I mentioned to you earlier. In this community, very close by, children, mostly Asians, who are potentially at risk of being seduced into following an extremist route. If those children are given a stake in the society where they live, if they are given the opportunity, as I said, to achieve the very most of their talents, if there is a culture of learning and of achievement, then the chances of those extremists gaining ground in those communities is diminished. And so, yes, of course, as liberals, we all want to be safe, and we want our country to be safe. But let's make sure we get the balance right between taking sensible measures to engage with those communities and to ensure that those people feel part of our society, But let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater, because you end up achieving the very opposite of what you seek to achieve.
Tim.
Yeah, I mean, I'm pretty intolerant of the government's approach on this. I'm not intolerant of many things. And I remember I got involved in student politics at a time when there were great attempts to bring in what we call no platform, gagging of people who are deemed to be extremists. And that included, for example, people who were Zionists. It also certainly included the British National Party and people like that. And the reality is that sends me cold, the notion that we would intervene to prevent people organising and speaking in ways that are powerful and important to them. We have laws in this country that deal with incitement to hatred and incitement to violence, and we should be resourcing the implementation of those laws. And that is sufficient. Now, that does not mean that we shouldn't be working alongside university authorities and students' unions to be able to tackle those issues, but undoubtedly, you end up making people martyrs, you end up fueling the cause of extremism if you give them an excuse by singling them out, which is why I always fall for those people with the most objectionable views to be allowed to speak in public, because that way they are exposed to debate and they're more likely to be ridiculed and to be defeated. That is essentially what it is to be a liberal. To be a liberal, to be tolerant, is not about agreeing with and putting up with people that you like and agree with. That is not tolerance. That is dead easy. Tolerance is about putting up with people you almost despise. And that is what makes a liberal Britain different, the kind of planned, clean, sort of sterile one that Blair envisaged. Our freedom is more diverse, it's more rugged, it is more real. And if you want to tackle extremism on campuses, understand how Britain is seen in the world elsewhere. Extremism on campuses began and was fueled in so many ways by idiotic, foolish, short-sighted foreign policy failures over the last 10 and 20 years. You want to know what the fuel was for so much of this stuff in the United Kingdom today? It was the illegal Iraq war. Britain acting as a world leader to build peace, to tackle climate change, rather than to take sides in great conflicts. That is a way of making sure that we have harmony here as well, not having stupid dog whistle politics about silencing a few, which ends up fueling their cause anyway.
Thank you. And building on that, we've had a lot of questions on specifically the EU referendum and some more wider international affairs. Chris Prahr sums it up in, how will you influence the internationalism debate, i.e. EU referendum, refugees and current wars? Tim, 1 minute.
1 minute. Right, here goes. Too much talk about the EU referendum and our support for an in vote. We've heard today that the vote will be yes when it comes to the referendum, is about the economic pragmatism and so on. And that is very important. We should make that case. We reckon 3 million jobs. We talk about 51% of our imports, 50% of our exports with the European Union. Of course, a real hard case. But like I said before, you only move people if you can get them in their gut. I tell you what, when you were sat around, if you were a minister in either this government or any other, you were sat around the table of the Council of Ministers in Europe, in Brussels, you will be sat around that table with 27 other ministers, six of whom represent countries that 25 years ago had nuclear weapons on their soil pointed right here. If that was the only reason for being in the European Union, that would do for me. That would do for me. The European Union is the world's most successful peace process, and it is an ongoing peace process. You can't tackle climate change in your silos. You can't tackle international extremism in your silos. You build peace, you tackle climate change, you build prosperous and fair communities if we work together. Our argument for a yes vote has got to be here and less there.
Norman.
Yeah, I agree with that, and I think we must always remind people of why the European Union is so important. So the fact that there were two world conflicts in our continent in the last century, and the fact that we've turned our back on that, and now we are trading together and working together in harmony. We may disagree, but we work together. This is a great triumph. It's a triumph of internationalism, and we ought to be very clear and open in making the case for that. But I also just want to raise one other point with you. Do we just dismiss people's anxieties about Europe, or do we seek to understand why people sometimes are worried about remote power? I think if you are to make the case for staying in Europe, which I fundamentally believe, we also have to be the party that is committed to reforming institutions that sometimes fail in Europe. Just ask yourself this question. We are the party that proudly argues the case for political and constitutional change in our own country. But sometimes we are silent about the need for change at the European level. And people who I know in my constituency, who in very many respects are strong supporters of me and of the Liberal Democrats, and who are liberals, are not that happy about Europe. And if we just dismiss their concerns, we will fail in the argument we make. So let's have two very strong emotions. Let's absolutely make the valued, principled case for staying in Europe, for looking out, not looking inwards, for being internationalist, for working with other countries to achieve the big challenges of our time. But let's also consistently be the party of reform. Let's not leave our critical faculties behind when it comes to applying them to the problems of Europe. Let's be self-confident in arguing the case for change, but in arguing the case for staying.
Louise Candler asks, should you become leader, what will your policies be regarding LGBT rights? Moving on from what we've achieved in government, and she gives the illustration of one in four teens who come out to their parents end up on the streets, so it's broader than same-sex marriage. Norman first.
Well, I come back to what I said at the start about the absolute importance of us celebrating diversity and promoting it wherever we can. And the central principle is that every individual should be treated as equal citizens, whoever they are, whatever their sexual preferences, however they choose to lead their life, if they're not harming other people. We as a party must ensure that we always, always stand up for those people's rights to live their life as they choose to. It's an absolutely central principle, so that in everything we do, we are consistent in that regard. One of the things that I did as a minister in the Department of Health was to challenge this extraordinary process of gender reassignment, gender therapy, what's it called? Conversion therapy, gay conversion therapy. This is just unbelievable. This is therapists who seek to cure people of their sexuality as if it's an illness. Now, we can't tolerate this sort of thing as a liberal society. People are who they are, and they have every right to be who they are. And so we managed to get a statement of principle with everyone signing up to it to commit to ensuring that this never happens under the NHS and that no one is ever referred to therapists who engage and indulge in this sort of quack therapy. We must always treat people with respect and allow them to be who they are.
Tim.
Yeah, I mean, the pretty heartbreaking stat in the question is fundamental. And how do we make sure that we have a society which demonstrates that everybody has not just got the right to be who they are and who they choose to be, to marry who they choose, for example, but they've also got the freedom from persecution for the lifestyles that they lead. So this is an ongoing process. And it's something that will only be achieved by a society that is open and acceptance of all minorities and does not put stigma upon anyone. And you ask about what we could do going forward. There's much more that could be done. I think a criticism of the Equal Marriage Act is that it is not sufficiently equal. And we talk about LGBT communities, and too often the T gets dropped off, missed out. The reality is that within the Equal Marriage Act, there is what's referred to as the spousal veto, which basically denies individuals who are transgendered the ability to be married to the person that they choose, or allow their existing partner to veto their transition. And in a free society, that is not acceptable. That is not acceptable. So progress being made, but insufficient. And it's also worth saying in terms of where we still sit in terms of pointless, unscientific, irrational prejudice, the ongoing gay blood ban. If there are scientific reasons why an individual should not give blood, fine, that can apply to any single one of us. But you do not carte blanche deny access to this service, should we say, to be able to provide this service to a single category of people. That is homophobic, and it's something that should be got rid of. And a promise I made to the Pink newspaper a week ago was that if I was to become leader, our first opposition day debate as a party would be on ending the gay blood ban.
Right, we've got time for two more questions and then a brief summing up from each of you. The first from Steve Bolter of the Green Lib Dems and Carol Griffiths from Tooting. Steve asks, what are the most important long-term policies that the UK should be adopting now to give future generations the fairest chance of a high quality of life in the second half of this century? I assume, Steve, you are referring specifically to green issues. Ah, OK. Well, I'm afraid I'm taking chair's perks on this because we're running out of time and we haven't tackled green issues yet. Carol asks, what would you do to green the machinery of government? Tim, you're first.
Right, OK. It's a bit of travesty. This is the first time we've really got to the issue properly tonight. Climate change is the biggest earthly threat facing humanity. And if you are concerned about the economy, about fairness and equality, you start with being concerned about tackling climate change. And the great fear I've got is that we haven't moved enough people in their hearts to desire to tackle this and realise it is of first importance. There is this sense that somehow this is an esoteric matter for Guardian readers, and it's not something that matter affects the rest of us. But the reality is that climate change is happening. It is clearly human-inspired and created. The science is pretty much unanimous on that now. And we're looking at temperature rises over the rest of this century, that first half of this century, of up to 7 degrees, but certainly 2 degrees. That is catastrophic. That is not esoteric. That is the forced mass movement of hundreds of millions of people through the desiccation or deluge of land. It means wars, famine, strife, and the whole shebang. If you think that is esoteric, I'm sorry, it isn't to me. So you tackle climate change as the most important thing, and you do it. Big problems need big answers. We're not going to move those people, the rest of society, to decide with us that it's so important unless you can convince them that it's something we can do together. So hair shirt and austerity will not convince enough people to change. It needs a huge infrastructure revolution. So we need to be, we've got the new tidal lagoon coming up in Swansea. We need about 35 of those. And given that 95% of the supply chain for hydro and tidal power is British, what a wonderful way of boosting our economy. This is not green crap that will limit our business opportunities, as Cameron says. It is absolutely the opportunity to end all opportunities. And that's what we need to do. We need to, if this is not a patriotic, all-consuming endeavour to green our economy and make it something that is base, that we base our future on, then we will not tackle climate change and will not move the people with us we need to. This is about communication as much as anything else.
Norman.
Well, as the son of a world-leading climatologist, I better stick with with the absolute imperative of tackling climate change. He set up, incidentally, the Climatic Research Unit at the University of East Anglia, which was the source of Climategate, if you remember, before the Copenhagen Summit, where there was a great furore about emails and what they said and suggestions that they were in some way exaggerating the claims. Incidentally, it was long after he died that those emails were written. But we grew up with this. This was part of our lives. And representing North Norfolk, I see in a small way, but a significant way for that community, that we are there on the front line of the impact of climate change. If we see that temperature rise that we've talked about, then sea level rise will go with it. And a significant proportion of my constituency will go underwater. Most MPs are worried about the Boundary Commission. I'm worried about the North Sea. But then you think about Bangladesh and the impact on millions of people who live at or around sea level. And the impact that then has in causing conflict, migration of people, and the impact then in terms of its lightened self-interest. We would not be able to cope with the flows of people that would emerge from that. So there is a case based on enlightened self-interest that we must tackle this greatest of all imperatives. You asked also about what we must do to green the government. One of my great frustrations as a minister is the sense that you could be doing things in your department
And another government department is doing something that is completely contradictory and undermining what you are seeking to achieve. And in mental health, sometimes things that happened in the Department of Work and Pensions were distinctly unhelpful. So joining up, making government more coherent, getting departments working together is of critical importance. Evidence-based policy making. I won an award, incidentally, from the Political Studies Association for the best case of evidence-based policy making. I'm very proud of that. We must ensure that every government department acts in a way that is not inconsistent with our pursuit of tackling climate change. That is not the case at the moment, but that must be a test that is applied to everything that government, and indeed local government, does. Because if we don't do that, then we will completely contradict ourselves and get nowhere. Just one final point. What we do internationally is also so important. So working through the European Union, ensuring that in the conference later this year, we deliver a good deal which achieves a significant move towards a low-carbon economy with the achievement of a zero-carbon economy by 2050, and then the work in the developing world to ensure that they are able to produce clean energy and not rely on out-of-date fuels and mechanisms that are so inefficient for those economies. Helping them to help themselves is a central part of our mission.
Okay, we're going to move now to the very brief closing statements. And I think, if you don't mind, Tim, I'll go with you first. Yeah, I'll be going round and round about, but I think you've got a couple of minutes off.
Okay, look. I don't think there's ever been more need for a Liberal Party in Britain. And I don't think there's ever been more threats to liberalism in Britain. And those two things sit together. And what we need to do as a party going forward now is to take advantage of what has clearly happened in these last 3 weeks. I mean, the 14,000 new members is staggering. I mean, clearly we should get annihilated more often. But, you know, it would be lovely. It would be lovely. I mean, most of you guys joined without anybody asking you. Just think what would happen if people actually went out there and asked. And that is what we must now do. So we have nearly 60,000 members now. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I hope in the next month we're going to get to 60,000. We've got to take that to 100,000 members by 2020. And along the way, we've got to be setting mileposts in terms of what we are doing to achieve progress, to make sure that we win those council seats. We are a grassroots party, and we have to win council seats first. We have to win coverage in areas that we have lost all representation in recent times. And out there, as I say, there are hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of Liberals. Our job is to turn them into Liberal Democrats. And our job is also to turn Liberal Democrats into winners. There is no doubt whatsoever that winning elections can change people's lives. Now, I want the kind of reputation for this party that we have managed, for example, in my constituency. Now, I talk about housing a lot, but I've said there's few things more important to people than their housing situation and their housing need. I went to a school in my constituency, the most deprived part of it, about 2 years ago, and I went for lunch with my assistant, Sam Holly, and bear in mind that we have spent this years and years as a party locally fighting the Tories to build affordable houses. They will say, not in my backyard. We say, no, we must build. We must build because otherwise local people have nowhere to live. Nobody who earns anything like a low wage or even a medium income has anywhere to live locally. So we fought our corner for fair housing and to build homes locally. And against that backdrop, I went to lunch at this primary school in my patch. And Holly was sat on one table, I was sat on another. And Holly sat next to this little girl who was 8, and she said, do you know who that is? Pointing at me. The little girl says, yeah, that's Tim Farron. Holly was dead impressed. Do you know what he does? Asked Holly. Yeah, he gets people houses. He gets people houses. And I absolutely, am absolutely convinced that if you can understand, as a movement, if we can understand as individuals, the immense difference you can make to people's lives if you win, then you make it much easier to win. Because I tell you what, if you are fueled with the knowledge that you knocking on doors, giving money that you can't afford, delivering leaflets, putting posters up, working on social media, giving your time and energy to the Liberal Democrats and to the Liberal movement, if you are convinced it will change lives, like clearly we changed the lives of that little girl in Kendal, then you will work 20 times harder. And I don't care how many newspapers Murdoch sells. I don't care how much money the Tories can spend on direct mail. There is nothing to beat a party and a movement with fire in its belly. And there is only one way back for this party over the next 5 years, and it is self-belief. It is infrastructure building, ward by ward, council by council, seat by seat. But to do that, you need the fuel and energy, the emotion, the belief that this party matters to Britain and that Britain needs the Liberals to survive and to thrive. And if you elect me as your leader and you do me that honour, my job is to communicate that passion around the party to every corner of it and to bring in those millions of people who believe what we believe but have not yet paid the subscription fee. Thank you.
First of all, thank you all so much for being here, and thank you for joining this party. It's just so important at that moment when we have suffered such a trauma that there are so many people who are willing to step up to the plate, and I really appreciate that. I would start by just again returning to the question, why? Why are we doing this? What are we doing it for? What's our purpose? And our purpose is to improve people's lives, to give people a better life, a happier life, not to be enslaved by poverty or conformity, to free people up to lead whatever life they choose to lead, to give people power. We have to be able to inspire people. If we can inspire all of those people out there who share our values, our liberal values, then I believe we have the real opportunity to build a popular, liberal, progressive movement of change that can challenge a Conservative government, that will drift to the right, that will get itself into all sorts of difficulties, that will divide over the European Union referendum. And just remember that the Labour Party will be inward-looking, will be confused about its position. They face an existential challenge themselves. How on earth do they ever get back into government given their disastrous loss of seats in Scotland? And it looks like they are into a headlong rush, into just repeating the mistakes of the past, not actually thinking about how politics needs to change. And there is an overwhelming need for a constructive, progressive, liberal alternative to the Conservatives in this country. And we can be the fulcrum around which people can gather as we build that movement. So let's be self-confident. Let's reach out and connect with all those people who share our values. And I feel, having done my work as a campaigning minister in one particular area of mental health, building the party's reputation, building the party, the people's trust in what we were seeking to do, being steadfast and consistent in what I was trying to do, winning new friends, pursuing a liberal mission to change people's lives, to enable people to have equal access to treatment that is at the moment denied to them. I believe that those values and the experience and the ability that I had to connect with people about what we were about in government in that area, in a liberal purpose, can be applied to our wider purpose to convince all of those people who share our values to join us in a movement that can challenge the Conservatives again. And remember again what we are about. We can only do anything if we get back in power. So let's set that as our mission, as our goal, as our objective. And if you share my view about the values that we hold and the importance of consistently articulating those values, then join me and support me in this election, because together we can succeed. Thank you very much.
Thank you both, Tim and Norman, very much. I'm sorry, we had far more questions than it was possible to ask, even those where they were in the same topic, many of the questions were different. But I happen to know that both Tim and Norman's websites have a facility for you to ask questions and communicate with them. So please feel free to go onto their websites. They're easy to find if you Google them. Also look out for their Facebook pages and for Twitter. They're both active on Twitter. And there are other Hustings, both the official ones in geographic areas, but also watch out because some of our special interest groups may well also be having Hustings, whether meetings like this or online ones, so do keep an eye out. As you leave, we have a bucket for donation forms, which I hope you've seen. If you're able to make a donation tonight to help us defray the cost of this evening, both the hall and the other things we've had to hire, that would be wonderful. And finally, I have some thanks. I want to thank the film crew for their work this evening, Claire Edwards for her amazing constitution, and Darren, Will, Emma, Bess, and everyone else who's made this evening possible. Thank you for coming. And you'll get more details about the vote for the leadership through your email box in the fairly short future. Thank you. Safe journey home.
And we should give Sal a round of applause as well for chairing it so well.